Hey everybody, welcome back to the shop. It's been a long time since my last video. I've been doing a lot of work on 2920, which is in for some fuel system work. We built this one in 2012. I don't think I did many videos of that. And right off screen is 2621, which we are building from the ground up. It's all covered step by step by agonizingly detailed, excruciating step in hours and hours and hours of video on Patreon. And if you want to basically know how to build your own jet engine, if you get one, that would be a good place to start. It's the least expensive jet course you're ever gonna find. It's $5 a month. Yes. Anyway, a couple updates. Gotta say thank you to Justin. Yes. Justin is it in Winnipeg? There's a different town on here, but he's at Red River College AME program, and he sent me a super cool logo shirt. And how did he know? How did he know that I am a large, but I prefer extra large because it's baggy and more comfortable in the summer? Super cool. Thank you very much. Shout out to the guys in the AME program there. We have a special feature today. I want to start a new thing that's going to be very relevant to the AME program at Red River College. So let's get right into it. This is so cool. Okay, so I go home yesterday, I pick up the mail, and I get a United States Postal Service priority mail envelope addressed to, look at the address. Yeah, anyway, I did find on the back of it, there's a little ticket here that does have, it's all sliced up and stuck back on, but it doesn't have my name. This used to cause problems in the local post office. It's addressed to Agent JZ at Jet City and my address. So before, the post office would not deliver these because they'll say they would want ID, and I'd show them my ID and they say, well, that's not you. And I go, well, what do you want me to say? People send me stuff. I can't control what they call me, and I don't have any ID that says Agent JZ or Agent JZ on it, not even my business cards. So I said to the lady at the post office, I said, look, if you take out your phone and type in Agent JZ, it'll just pop up like zillions of them. And they're like, well, that's not part of my job, post office worker, right? So I ended up, this was years ago, with piles and piles of packages that I couldn't get at the post office. And that's why I created the program or the contest to give away the compressor blade, the fan blade. Anyway, I still have all the entries. It's a big box at home, and it caused a bit of a kerfuffle at the post office. And I said, look, you know, that's me. Go check. Anyway, so enough of that. This was so cool. It comes in a B-58 envelope, and get this. I think I want to call this segment, we're going to start a new series of videos. I'm not sure what to call them. I need your ideas in the comments. I was going to call it Jet Stories with Jay, or Doing It Right, Stories from the Hangar, or something like that. But this is version one. And oh boy, do we have a story. And I have some additional information to add to this that may be interesting or useful. So, it starts off. 1964, Bunker Hill Air Force Base, Peru, Indiana, J-79 engine repair shop. And of course, there's a beautiful picture of a B-58, which of course ran four J-79s. Talk about fuel consumption with afterburners. I saw a young mechanic grinding something on the bench grinder. I was curious and investigated. He doesn't talk about what his rank was here, I don't think. Anyway, to my amazement, he was grinding on a J-79 fuel nozzle. We'll get to that. I got some right here. I told him that he could not do that. I asked if he had checked with his crew chief before he decided to do that. So I guess a young mechanic, so not an apprentice, maybe an apprentice, but a mechanic. And the crew chief is the guy, one guy handles one aircraft. He's in charge of everything. So this mechanic would be working for him. And I guess maybe this guy was in a different trade, or maybe he was the supervisor of maintenance. I'm not sure. He doesn't say that here. He said that the sergeant said it was okay. He continued to grind and would not listen to my warnings. Okay? Shortly thereafter, we hadn't a turbine section disintegrate. Shortly thereafter, we had a turbine section disintegrate at high power setting on the test cell. And believe me, that would sound like a bombing run hitting the building. The whole turbine section was completely destroyed. The ground down area of the fuel nozzle had broken away and injected a large solid stream of fuel downstream like a cutting torch, destroying the nozzles and turbine wheels. So we'll get to my guess of what that sounded like in a second. The concrete test cell containment area looked like it had been riddled with machine gun fire. Now what? How many of these ground down fuel nozzles were on aircraft? We had several aircraft on 24-hour alert at all times, all loaded with nuclear weapons, B-58 bombers in the 1960s. Yes, they were loaded with nukes and they were flying. Not to mention the rest of the wing. The powers that be decided that it was not logistically feasible to check every nozzle. Due to the B-58's design, every engine would have to be removed from the aircraft to accomplish this task. Yeah, you can't get at the fuel nozzles when it's in the nacelle, usually. You've got to take the engine out. Their plan was to estimate how many engines had been in the shop during a predetermined time frame and inspect those engines and hope for the best. Now, I would have checked the records of where the young mechanic had been working, and hopefully they keep track of that kind of thing, and how long he had access to the engines and how long he might be doing that, and possibly, most certainly, have an interview with the young man to figure out what's going on, how long have you been doing this, but whatever. If a nozzle failed in flight, the aircraft would be lost and the flight crew would be in a serious situation. It's hard to get out of a B-58, even though I think there's only three people in it. Maybe four. Anyway, Grinder Boy's crew chief ended up working in the food service warehouse. I'm sure that his career was severely stifled, not to mention the turbine shop higher-ups and the field maintenance squadron. The complete United Airlines airframe and engine overhaul base in San Francisco is powered by a stationary General Electric CF6 gas turbine engine, which is the basis for a LM2500. Basically, we have in our shop, we've converted a CF6 to a 2500. It runs 24/7, never shuts down even for oil changes. You can basically add oil to the reservoir and drain oil while it's running. I was amazed by this, as CF6s are not that long-lasting on the airframe. I'm told that the constant speed helps the engine last much longer as a GPU than on the wing. Because it stays at the same temperature all the time, full load. Even though it's hot, it doesn't go hot and cold cycles, which is the cause of cracking eventually, and cracking is how a jet engine wears out and eventually becomes non-serviceable. Curious to hear how the J79s are used as GPUs. On wing, they required constant maintenance. Yes, well, the core of S&S Turbines' business, S&S Turbines, I'm wearing their t-shirt, is the LM1500, which is the ground-running equivalent of the J79. And they run for tens of thousands of hours because they are constantly at wide open, foot to the floor, flat-out power, and they don't change temperature at all. They're used around here at natural gas compression stations on a large pipeline. It takes a great amount of power to move natural gas down a pipeline, and LM1500s have, after their reduction gearbox and all that, they're about 12,000 horsepower when you want it, wherever you want it. Shortly thereafter, I was shipped out to Vietnam, got home and went on into aviation. Spent 14 years in the turbine engine shop at United Airlines O'Hare facility, many more on aircraft. Thanks for your great videos, brings back a lot of memories. And that was from Scott in Arlington Heights, Illinois. Very cool. So, why is this story relevant? Oh yeah, before I get to that. So I saw the envelope and I thought, oh, it's gonna be a picture. I love this picture. And I thought, I was already thinking about the frame I was gonna get for this picture and I'm gonna hang it up in the shop. Ooh, super cool, super cool. And I open up and this, I go, oh, it's a letter. And there's like, oh, no picture. Then I turn the last page over and something way cooler. Look at this. 305th bomb wing with a B-58 on the patch. My buddies who fly Sabres, T-33s, F-5s, and T-6s They're going to be impressed with that. I'm going to put a Velcro patch on my jacket to go to Oshkosh with a freaking B-58 patch. That is awesome. That is awesome. Anyway, why is this relevant to Red River College? Let's get to that. Alrighty. Okay, so grinding a J79 fuel nozzle. What we have here is the combustor for a low smoke can, the combustor liner, and a what we call a standard can, the first generation and second generation, you could call it. Here's the first generation fuel nozzle. It's this size, and it goes, let's see. I've made some videos on fuel nozzles. Have a look at my jet fuel nozzles series, but anyway, we'll recap that. This is the old model. Where is it? That's the old model. That's the new one. Let's see, they're the same. There we go. And they look like this. Okay, old one, new one. So low smoke and standard. And 1964 would have been right around the time when the second generation of fuel nozzles would be coming out. So you could have these in the shop at the same time. This one goes in the old school can. Let's see if we can see that. Where are you? Can you see that? Not really. Let's see if we can lower this a little bit, maybe. Something like that. Where are we? There we go. You see that fuel nozzle hole? Well, this one just fits, it just fits in there snugly. Nice snug fit. So there you go. That's the right fuel nozzle and the right liner. This is the older first generation, what we call standard cans, and they're not used in industrial engines because they're the ones that make all the black smoke. They're less efficient and they make more pollution. Okay, let's switch to the other one. All right, let's see if I can do this without causing anything to crash onto the ground. Okay, this is a low smoke can right there. You got that? Okay, and there's the fuel nozzle, and it goes in. When it's in the engine, it will be right like that. And you can see it's got a little sort of, they call it a ferrule, but it blocks airflow except for, well, it blocks all the airflow because the fuel nozzle fits into it, but it allows some movement. Anyway, this type of combustor uses slightly more air for combustion of the fuel. It burns leaner. Okay, things might look a little bit differently for this particular clip because this one was corrupted and caused my editing software to crash several times. So we're going to do it over again. It's the next day. Things are a little different, but almost the same. This is a working shop and work has been done since we were here. Anyway, so where were we? I think that it might have been possible back in the day, back in 64, that, both types of engines might have been in the shop as the... It was actually a mod kit to an existing J79 as well. You would get different combustors, the low smoke combustors and the new fuel nozzles. What else was it? I think that was it. Fuel nozzles and combustors, yeah, they were changed. Everything else was basically the same. Maybe they had a bunch of mod kits, maybe they had a bunch of modded engines, a bunch of new engines, a bunch of old engines, a bunch of parts, probably the same two or these two different things in the same base at the same time, because how many B-58s were there? Each one has four J-79s and probably a couple spares. I think that, anyway, I think the decision not to take every engine out of every plane and check every single one was, unless they were totally certain about this new guy, where he was working and when he was working, it was rather foolish, because the risk taken with supersonic bombers carrying tens of thousands of gallons of fuel, let alone nuclear weapons. Come on now, you have to be 100% sure. That's what this whole occupation and trade is about. But anyway, it might have been possible for Johnny Rocketbox to go for this shelf instead of that shelf and grab some old school fuel nozzles because he didn't know there was two kinds. Maybe he was really brand new. And he thought, well, that doesn't go, but really, if you look at them, there's the diametrical difference right there. So I could probably grind that down a bit to make it fit in that hole. I probably could. But you'll also notice that the length is different. And so this one, if you ground it down to fit into that hole, which is a crime against humanity, but anyway, if you did that, it would be spurbling fuel into a tube, which would then dribble and schnoodle and snort and sneezle out of there, making a mess. And so I'm guessing the test cell did have a direct duct that went into a hush chamber or a muffler or a stack or something, because the exhaust from the engine, even before a piece broke off, would be fiery and wet and disgusting and tons and tons and tons of black smoke. So there he goes. And he says, well, I got to take an eighth of an inch off all the way around. So just on a grinder. And he's thinking, wow, you know, there's 10 fuel, not 10 of these I got to do. And he's grinding away, tons of sparks. And, you know, if you have to deburr something like this to fit into a jet engine, what you do, just a second. Okay, this one's scrap, but you're dealing with military turbojet engines. And if you get one that has like a line or a ridge or a flash or something, a burr you've got to remove, maybe down on this flange here, this is the mounting flange, but up here, there wouldn't be anything here. There, see these welds here? See those welds? If those were a little bit bigger and interfered with something, you'd take yourself a file, and you would, there we go, we're taking off a burr. Okay, that's what you're doing. You're not going up to a bench grinder and like, come on. Anyway, I was gonna say that's common sense, but of course you know there's no such thing. And it was a carelessness on the part of, well, it was complete ignorance and lack of situational awareness on Mr. Johnny Rocketbox there. But his supervisor, it was also incredible carelessness on his part to not check what the heck the guy's talking about. What do you mean you gotta grind it? Like, how? Grind how? Bit of Scotch-Brite or a bench grinder? It boggles the mind. Anyway, so there he goes. He grinds them down and he puts it in the engine, because this height from the mounting flange right here, right there, to the top of the angle piece, it's the same. And if you grind it enough, this will fit. This will fit into an old school can. All right. Or, let's see, the new school, it would go right in. So that's not what he did. He ground down what we call a standard can, a standard nozzle, a high smoke nozzle, the black smoke nozzle, ground it down so it would fit into the ferrule of a low smoke can. And it would. So the fact that it takes hours to install the fuel nozzles in a J79, especially with all the accessories and the wires and the cables and the hoses and the pumps and stuff along the bottom, it's very intensive work. So somehow he managed to work away unsupervised and hammer all those in, get them all tightened up, and then they sent the engine to test cell. Somebody would have signed off that the job was done, but obviously didn't watch him do it, because, come on. Anyway, that's a case of complacency, assumption, ignorance, and I don't know what else. I don't know what other nasty word I want to use. Anyway, so even before the end blew off, this becoming a garden nozzle, even before that, the fuel would be burning terribly in these new cans, because the distribution of the fuel would be just spraying and droplets, and it's just a mess. It wouldn't be a fine mist. The pattern of fuel distribution out of a jet engine nozzle, the pattern is more important than anything. You're looking for, when you're testing them, you're looking for streaks, blank spots, dribbling, anything like that. It should be a fine mist, a lot like the things that are over the lettuce in the grocery store, hopefully, if you have any lettuce in your grocery store. Kaboom, boom, boom. And that cost, from the description we got from Scott, it was, a minimum of $10 million in damage. In today's money, probably $10 to $20 to $50 million in damage. And if it ever happened in an airplane, well, I mean, come on. So the amount of ineptitude that led to the fact, it wasn't just the guy doing it, but the amount of ineptitude in the management chain and the whole organization that allowed that to happen. Somebody, a lot of people just weren't thinking. So your job in the AME program at BCIT or Red River College or Embry-Riddle or anywhere else in the world that you're learning how to be an aircraft mechanic or an aircraft engine mechanic is you've got to watch out for things like this. You've got to watch out for the first two or three steps that lead to a cascade of idiocy that causes disasters like that. Because this disaster was completely, totally, easily avoidable by having one brain cell shake hand with the other. Like, geez, how did that happen? That's like putting a chimpanzee in charge of a bulldozer downtown New York City and say, yeah, do your best. Come on now. Anyway, a fantastic story, and I really appreciate it. If anybody else, any veterans or any other not even non-military veterans of airline service or air show service or aircraft mechanic stories, I would like this to become a new feature. And it's they're basically cautionary tales. That's the term I was looking for yesterday. They're cautionary tales of how not to do it. And even if they're close calls are way better than disasters. We want to hear about both. So, and also, I do want to mention that this trade, it's not heavy-duty mechanics, it's not truck mechanics, it's physically not very demanding, and that's why I need to exercise, because I'm withering away with the physical demands of this job, which really aren't that many. So because of that, and another reason, most of us boys, we learn through bicycles, skateboards, lawnmowers, chainsaws, whatever. We think we know how to do things. And so we can sometimes assume we know what we're doing when we don't. And so when you're confronted with something with like a fuel nozzle that just won't fit, instead of looking in the instructions and wondering why and asking questions, we just hammer on ahead and grind it and slam it in and things blow up. So girls aren't like that. If a girl says that this won't go in there, she'll ask her coworker or maybe the supervisor, or probably even smarter, go look at the book and realize, oh, there's two different ones. There's mod number whatever, I don't know what the mod is, but it's a low smoke kit. It includes the nozzles and the combustors. And so then she would realize, oh, you know what, this is the wrong part. We went to the wrong shelf, and go over and get the right stuff, put it in the right way, everything's good. This is a long-winded way of saying that, yes, women make very good jet engine technicians because they don't make dumbass assumptions, and they want to make sure they know what they're doing before they do it. They don't just assume they know what they're doing. And so in our little circle here in this town, Jet City, my company is named after Fort St. John because we have, I think, 6 turbine engine companies in a town of 15,000 people. Some of our best technicians have been women. So there's hope for everybody, and I wish everybody success in their career. And yeah. All right, so that's our cautionary tale this time. And it's extremely relevant to all you students out there and all of us working. The world's been changing. I think aviation's becoming less safe, not more safe. Still really safe. But anyway, based on the recommendation by our resident visiting engineer, Graham, I bought a book about aircraft maintenance safety. And it's called Flight Failure. I'm just getting into the first chapter. And I just want to read to you, where is it? This is part of the introduction. And this is very interesting. Okay, unlike in years past, much maintenance at the major airlines is outsourced to independent overhaul bases. Some of the facilities are overseas and poorly supervised. Regardless of where the work is performed, stress, inadequate training, poor communication between work shifts, and other issues continue to result in deadly outcomes. What you're about to read are accurate accounts of why accidents occur for the smallest of reasons, quite literally. He's talking about hardware, nuts, bolts, cotter pins, safety wire, that kind of stuff. The stuff that you do. This book presents information gleaned from thousands of pages of accident reports combined with firsthand knowledge accumulated during my years in the aviation industry. Demystifying technical issues behind these accidents and understanding how they might be prevented in the future is my interest. Aviation is unforgiving. It always will be. When it comes to maintaining airplanes properly, a zero tolerance standard is imperative. Unfortunately, that lofty goal is not attained, has not been attained. And on the very back, this is quite cool. The author's name is Donald Porter. He goes, Porter recommends that the number and job security of airline mechanics be increased and that they be vested with an authority level akin to medical professionals. Wouldn't that be great? How many times, well, if you're a student, not yet, but how many times as a professional working in the field have you worked for an idiot or had an idiot as a supervisor who was hired because he was somebody's friend versus his qualifications? Oh, I have, let me tell you. Anyway, I suggest, we're gonna revisit this book once I've finished it, but I suggest if you're a student at a school, either buy this book right there. I'm not gonna give you any ISBN numbers or references or links, or this is the name of the book, that's the name of the author. If you can't find it with that, then you don't belong in that class. Anyway, if you don't wanna spend I think it was about $30 Canadian, it says $18 US on here, get your school to buy it for their library. This is highly relevant to people turning the wrenches and calibrating the equipment working on aircraft. And try to remember that it's not about keeping your supervisor happy. It's not about just doing what you're told to do or what you're paid to do. What is the most important part of the job that you do as an aircraft maintenance engineer or mechanic or technician? The most important consideration is the quality of the job as it leaves the shop. So if you keep that in mind, you'll be okay. Don't just say, well, I tried. Well, I did what I was supposed to do. The other guy did the wrong thing. I mean, yeah, whatever. Do your best. That's what I always say here. We check, 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 double check, triple check, quad check, and then before you ship it, check it again. Because it is uncompromising, it's unforgiving, and things that are easy to stop on the side of the road with your car, they can bring a plane down. So always remember that. You can be that medical level authority. Someday that might happen, I hope so. And I should point out, I have no connection whatsoever with this book. I'm endorsing it, but it's not a paid endorsement. I've never talked to the author, I have nothing to do with it. And also, the question comes from the back of the class. Do we need to read this to do our job? No. If you want a job working on jet engines, you can get one. But this is what I would call extracurricular interest reading. Reading this book will make you a better technician because you're interested in the field. You're not just showing up, punching your card, and sticking bolts in. You know, is it just a job or is it a calling? I don't know. It's up to you. Anyway, yeah. I'm not associated with this book in any way, but I highly recommend it. So yeah, we can all learn from this cautionary tale. Was this a close call or a maintenance nightmare? I would say it was a maintenance nightmare. A chain of, what's the word, complacent, a chain of complacency and, ignorance. A chain of complacency and incompetence led to an absolute disaster. So it's your job to not be part of that. Not be part of that. From Jet City Turbines in Fort St. John, thanks for watching. And check out my Patreon channel. I think it's patreon.com/AgentJZ. AgentJZ, AgentJZ. They're both equivalent. So thanks for watching.